Good evening, I'm Ron Della Chiesa. Welcome to Boston Symphony Hall, world-renowned for its fabulous acoustics. In a concert by the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus, conducted by Scott Allen Jarrett and David Hoose. On the first half of the program is the Requiem of Gabriel Fauré, conducted by Scott Allen Jarrett, with soprano Ruby White and baritone Benjamin C. Taylor. This Requiem is quite brief, less than half the length of the Requiems of Verdi and Berlioz, and none of the blazing fire of those works. The composer stated, "My Requiem has been said to express no fear of death. It has been called a lullaby of death. But that is how I feel about death, a happy deliverance, a reaching for eternal happiness, rather than a mournful passing. Perhaps I have sought to depart from what is conventional, because for so long I was organist at services of internment. I'm fed up with that. I wanted to do something different." Here's David Hoose, Scott Allen Jarrett, and Ruby White on the Fauré Requiem.
The Fauré Requiem is serenely positive, not full of mourning. There's only really one moment in the piece when the Dies Irae text comes, which is no composer in his or her right mind would not respond to with some ferocity. But mostly the piece has a peace in it, an inner peace, a quietness.
A concert goer who is familiar with these sorts of work sees the term Requiem. They instantly call to mind, you know, Mozart or Verdi. The thing that you will notice immediately with Fauré is a gentleness, a solemnity, an elegance, and a focus on tenderness with the piece.
I love that imagery of a lullaby of death. I think that's exactly what the Pia Jesu in this is doing, grant us eternal rest. It was originally intended for a boy soprano to be singing. So that childlike purity, asking for eternal rest, there is something morbidly beautiful about that, I think.
Right away, you notice that he chooses not to set the longest portion of the Requiem Mass text, which is the Dies Irae sequence. The only portion of that text he uses is the last stanza, Pia Jesu, and he puts it out of order liturgically as the central movement of the work sung by solo soprano.
The Pia Jesu in this, the orchestration comes down, it's over strings. Again, it's a very quiet moment. It's just me and the orchestra together. And it's quiet, so I get to use a lot of different colors that I wouldn't normally get to use if I had to worry about competing with a full bodied orchestra that's blasting away and a chorus of hundreds of people that are also blasting away as well. I wouldn't really be able to compete with that.
As this piece unfolds, I think we really hear Fauré not just as a composer, but specifically as an organist. He is drawing an orchestral color that, to my ear at least, reflects his understanding of how one draws stops on an organ. So you might have a sound of a certain kind of flute, but you might like it in combination with another kind of flute. So you're pulling several stops that are of the same family or the same general sonority. And that invites both a thickening but also perhaps a softening of a texture. And you see that extended to the way he writes for the strings. You'll notice that the violas are divided into and the cellos are divided into, and the violins play in unison. So instead of two violin independent parts, single viola, single cello, the division of the orchestra string texture is very low. That texture pervades the piece. By contrast, there's extraordinarily bright, crisp, and light texture that happens notably in the Imparadisum at the end, but in the middle movement in the Sanctus. So you find a levity, sort of hovering of the texture that he's able to create in several movements by contrast to those more richly orchestrated, denser movements. The Fauré Requiem exists in a variety of versions and editions. So the version you'll hear, it features a full string section, still divided violas and cellos with the violins playing in unison. There are additional wind parts in trombone, trumpets, timpani, but they're used very sparingly so as not to betray the original sonority of the original arrangement of the piece.
Fauré wrote the first version of the Requiem in 1888, scored for a very modest ensemble. No violins except for a solo in the Sanctus, and no winds. Later versions added winds and violins, and the final published version is for full orchestra, though with a very sparing use of brass. In 1905, Fauré was appointed director of the Paris Conservatory. His students were his greatest champions, Maurice Ravel, Charles Cuchulain, George Enesco, and Nadia Boulanger. Some 13 years after Fauré's death, in November 1924, Nadia Boulanger was the first woman to conduct the Boston Symphony. On that February 1938 program was the Requiem of Gabriel Fauré in its first Symphony Hall performance. Though the Requiem by Fauré appears very frequently on concert programs throughout the area, as it is a very popular piece with choruses of every type, it isn't performed all that often in Symphony Hall. Perhaps besides Nadia Boulanger, only Charles Munch and Seiji Ozawa conducted the Boston Symphony in the Fauré Requiem, and the most recent BSO performances were back in March of 1994. We're quite certain that the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus have presented the Fauré Requiem here at Symphony Hall since then. Now the stage door has opened, and as you can see, they're coming on stage. Soprano Ruby White, followed by Benjamin C. Taylor, our baritone, and conductor Scott Allen Jarrett. Joining the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus, already on stage and live from Boston Symphony Hall, they'll perform the Requiem by Gabriel Fauré.
Thank you.
In Paradisum, there may the chorus of angels receive thee, and with Lazarus once a beggar, may thou have eternal rest, the final words of the Fauré Requiem that we just heard performed from Symphony Hall. Performing with the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus, with soprano Ruby White and baritone Benjamin C. Taylor, all under the direction of Scott Allen Jarrett. Our conductor and soloists still on stage. Scott Allen Jarrett, director of music at BU's Marsh Chapel and director of choral activities at interim at Boston University. Coming out to the stage podium with our soloists, soprano Ruby White, who earned her master's degree at Boston University in 2014, and she continues with BU's Opera Institute. And baritone Benjamin C. Taylor was a district winner and regional finalist in the New England Regional Metropolitan Opera National Council auditions last January. All of them on stage now. Scott Allen Jarrett, who conducted the Fauré Requiem, soprano Ruby White, baritone Benjamin C. Taylor, and the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus, all being acknowledged for the performance of this wonderful, sublime piece, the Fauré Requiem, live from Symphony Hall. Now, still to come on this live webcast from Symphony Hall is Stravinsky's Perséphone, to be conducted by David Hoose, in his final appearance as Director of Orchestral Activities here at Boston University. We have the following statement from Richard Cornell, Director ad interim of the Boston University School of Music. Our hearts are saddened by the events in Syria, in Egypt, in Beirut, and now in the City of Light, Paris. When we programmed tonight's concert, and even when we began rehearsing it, we could not have had any idea how poignant, how relevant, how appropriate these repertoire choices would be in mid-November and the last few days. They are powerfully redeeming works from the center of French culture. With Fauré's Requiem, we have a piece that beautifully and peacefully commemorates those who have only recently been lost to us. Within it is a heavenly vision, peace and deliverance. In Stravinsky's setting of Gide's libretto, we have a biting theme of ever-returning spring and a neoclassic expression, cool, delicate, and reassuring. Quote, whatever the world needs in order to heal, music certainly must do its part. I'm Ron Della Chiesa at Symphony Hall. This concert is dedicated to the memory of BU Professor Joe Shevelov, who passed away earlier this month. He taught at the School of Music for 46 years. Typical of his character, as noted in tonight's program book by Richard Cornell, was his agreeing to accept only a portion of the Metcalf Award in 2004 on the condition that the remainder be established for a scholarship fund as a memorial for BU faculty member John DeVario, who had tragically passed away the previous year. Furthermore, Joel Shevorov insisted that the prize be matched by then BU president John Silber. A memorial event for Joel Shevorov will be announced at a later date. And just this past weekend was the sad news of the death of Joseph Silverstein. In addition to being concertmaster of the Boston Symphony from 1962 to 1984, and music director of the Utah Symphony from 1984 to 1998, Joseph Silverstein was the principal conductor of the Boston University Symphony Orchestra for more than a decade and taught violin at BU. Just earlier this month, Joseph Silverstein gave a recital at the CFA Concert Hall on the BU campus for the benefit of the Center for Beethoven Research at Boston University, featuring naturally an all-Beethoven program, the first and last violin sonatas, as well as the final string trio. To conclude this concert by the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus is a performance of Persephone by Igor Stravinsky. The title role will be spoken by Sara Heaton, and Eumolpe will be sung by tenor Yeghishe Manucharyan. On the podium, in his last appearance as director of orchestral activities, is David Hoose. He provides us with an introduction to Stravinsky's 1934 composition.
Stravinsky's Persephone is a kind of retelling of the ancient Greek myth of Persephone, who is the daughter of the queen of agriculture. Persephone one day is in the fields of flowers and is picking flowers, and the earth opens up and she is pulled down into the underworld, where she by force is made into the wife of Hades. At some point, not surprisingly, she begins to yearn for life on the earth. She escapes from Hades and is brought up to the earth again, but only with an agreement. Every year, she will return to the underworld for 3 months. The entire story symbolizes in some way the seasons of the year. Every year, we go into winter for 3 months or maybe more, and then are reborn with spring. So it is a story of rebirth and of renewal of the earth, as in the Rite of Spring. And it is seen by a lot of people as a composition that is the opposite twin of his early composition, the Rite of Spring. Unlike the Rite of Spring, which was radical for its time and is violent, very little of this piece is violent. It's quite serene. In the original Greek story, Persephone is literally pulled down into Hades, into the underworld. In André Gide's and Stravinsky's telling, it is really more of a choice that she makes. The kind of self-sacrifice that Persephone makes invites the multiplicity of interpretations of the story, that the original story, where she is forced down into the underworld, doesn't allow. Persephone was written as a ballet, and that's how it was presented the first time. It's an odd duck, as it were, and that is that there is a relatively prominent part for the chorus. There are only two characters who speak or sing. The narrator, whose part is sung by a tenor, and the title role, that is a spoken role. It's almost the opposite of what you would expect. You'd expect that the narrator would speak and that Persephone would sing, but he turns it on its head. It's very interesting interesting idea. Persephone is clearly associated with the neoclassic period of Stravinsky, where the musical language becomes, on the surface, much simpler than it was in the 19-teens. And I think he is reacting against the German expressionist music that was getting actually more complex. And he was hunting for a kind of clarity of expression, a clarity of thought. Persephone is really mature music. It requires a lot of the performers, it requires a lot of the listener. In fact, not because it's difficult, but because it kind of lies there and asks you, the listener, or us, the performers, to find our way into it. And when we do that, when we do open ourselves to it, then I think the piece is probably the greatest piece of Stravinsky that no one knows.
Stravinsky's Persephone owes its genesis to one of the most famous personalities of the early 20th century, the dancer and actress Ida Rubinstein. Ida Rubinstein was tall, beautiful, and from one of the wealthiest families in Russia. Moving to Paris at the beginning of the 20th century, she created a sensation by performing the Dance of the Seven Veils from Salome. Well, her Jewish Orthodox family was horrified by the news of the complete striptease. They had her committed to an insane asylum in order to save the family reputation. Ballet impresario Sergei Diaghilev, who knew a box office sensation when he saw one, engaged her in 1909 in a staging of Cleopatra. And he followed that 2 years later with a production of Scheherazade. And from this point on, she was the darling of the Paris art world. And there are a number of significant paintings of her in galleries today to prove it. By 1911, her own wealth and established fame allowed her to commission quite a number of composers for works where she would both dance and act. First among these was Debussy's The Martyrdom of Saint Sebastian. Upon seeing the production with Debussy's gorgeous 50-minute score, the great novelist Marcel Proust declared, "I found the legs of Mademoiselle Rubinstein sublime. To me, this was everything." Easily the most famous work that she commissioned for her use was a 15-minute work from Maurice Ravel, where her dancing threw all into a frenzy, the Bolero. It wasn't until early 1933 that Ida Rubinstein commissioned Stravinsky for Persephone. By this time, she was 50, and the combination of her age and the worsening political situation made it the swan song of her career. She danced and spoke Persephone's lines in the Paris premiere, April 30th, 1934. Well, within a year, Stravinsky was here in Boston, and it was here at Symphony Hall that the composer gave the American premiere of Persephone with the Boston Symphony Orchestra in March of 1935. One of many visits Stravinsky made to Boston, by the way. There was no dancing, and the work was presented in much the same manner as we see this evening. Nearly two decades later, Igor Stravinsky conducted the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and Chorus in the Boston premiere of The Rake's Progress. And he highly approved of the BU production by the up-and-coming Sara Caldwell and was moved by it, according to her. By all reports, the BU students hung onto his every word in rehearsal. In contrast, he hated the Metropolitan Opera production, which was the American premiere just a few weeks earlier. And matters weren't helped by Met conductor Fritz Reiner, who made caustic comments about the score in the composer's presence. Well, after the successful BU production of The Rake's Progress in May of 1953, Boston University proposed to Stravinsky that they commission him for another opera, with the libretto to be written by none other than Dylan Thomas. The plot concerned the rediscovery of our planet following a nuclear holocaust, complete with a rediscovery of language, a stripped-down means of communication down to its musical essence, an aspect that is very important in Persephone. Sadly, Dylan Thomas died before the project got very far. Stravinsky never one to go into purple prose over a death of a colleague. For example, he had nothing to say worth printing about Koussevitzky when he died in 1951, made the grand exception for Dylan Thomas with his orchestral work In Memoriam, Dylan Thomas. Conducting Persephone is David Hoose. He's been director of orchestral activities at Boston University School of Music since 1987. And tonight, as we said, marks his final appearance in this position. David Hoose has been music director of the Cantata Singers and Ensemble since 1987 and music director of Collage New Music since 1991. Very active in the Boston area, he's conducted the Handel and Haydn Society, Chorus Pro Musica, the Boston Symphony Chamber Players. And now, as you can see, coming on stage, our narrator, Sara Heaton, tenor Yeghishe Manucharyan, and conductor David Hoose, joining the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and chorus, already on stage. And from Boston Symphony Hall, this is Persephone by Igor Stravinsky.
Oh, compagne charmante, comment pourrais-je avec vous désormais rire et chanter insouciante, à présent que j'ai vu, à présent que je sais qu'un peuple insatisfait souffre et vit dans l'attente.
Thank you. per la via eternale.
Che feci sì?
Ti regna sur le sombre.
Ombre plaintive, que faites-vous?
Thank you.
prenez ces pierreries. La plus fragile fleur des prairies met une préférable parure.
Mercurium, sangue, et pétant sirine.
alternant les accents de nos voix affligées. Des rivières figées, cessez la fuite en pleurs des ruisseaux et leurs voix s'étouffer sous le gel. Dans les nocturnes bois, je vois ma mère, errante et de haillons vêtue, redemander partout Perséphone perdue. Elle marche, elle porte une torche à la main. Ronces, cailloux aigus, vents, ramures noueuses, pourquoi déchirez-vous sa course douloureuse? Mère, ne cherche plus. Ta fille qui te voit habite les enfers et n'est plus rien pour toi. Hélas, hâte du moins ma parole égarée pouvait.
If spring is to be reborn, the seed must die beneath the ground to reappear as a golden harvest in years to come. Closing lines, the work you just heard live from Boston Symphony Hall. That was Persephone by Igor Stravinsky. Narrating the title role was Sara Heaton, and the role of Eumolpe was sung by tenor Yeghishe Manucharyan. On the podium was David Hoose. In his final appearance as director of orchestral activities at Boston University. And here he comes again on stage, David Hoose. He's been director of orchestral activities at BU School of Music since 1987, and tonight marks his final appearance in this position. There's a note in the program In a tribute to David Hoose from Phyllis Hoffman, who was director of the School of Music from 1996 to 2001, she writes in part, David Hoose leaves a legacy of artistic integrity, brilliance, excellence, and the enduring truth that music is the ultimate barometer of the human condition. We salute him with our abiding admiration, appreciation, and affection. And he, in turn, is being saluted by the audience here in Symphony Hall, all the members of the orchestra and the chorus, David Hoose acknowledging the members of the orchestra section by section. Sara Heaton, who spoke the lines in Persephone tonight, no stranger to Boston concertgoers. She has performed and recorded with Boston Baroque and sang Juliet in the sold-out performance of Kongo's Der Todesstaat with Odyssey Opera, and singing Eumolpe, Tenor Yeghishe Manucharyan has sung at Opera Boston, Odyssey Opera, the Boston Modern Orchestra Project, the Boston Concert Opera, and the Masterworks Chorale. All of them now standing next to David Hoose, Sara Heaton, Yeghishe Manucharyan, and of course, the members of the Boston University Symphony Orchestra stomping their feet along with the chorus in appreciation for our conductor, David Hoose. He's back on stage facing the orchestra and the chorus. Now takes his bow here in Symphony Hall. A most appreciative audience tonight for that performance of Persephone. And earlier, of course, we heard the Fauré Requiem. Quite a night here in Symphony Hall for all the members of the Boston University Symphony Orchestra and chorus. As the applause continues, the audience here demanding again that our conductor come out. Stage door is open. And first, Sara Heaton, who spoke the lines of Persephone tonight, and as Eumolpe, tenor Yeghishe Manucharyan. Conductor David Hoose, he is sort of heading to the podium. He's not quite there yet. Bowing off to the right of the stage, enjoying the applause here from the audience here in Symphony Hall. So glad that you could join us tonight. I'm Ron Della Chiesa from Boston Symphony Hall.